damage to agriculture brought by the El Nino phenomenon is approaching the 4 billion peso mark. A United Nations delegation visited Filipino communities to assess and help them navigate the impacts of the weather phenomenon. We're joined by Rina Gilani, UN Assistant Secretary General. Ms. Rina, thank you so much for joining us here on Daytime Philippines on ANC.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
When you talk about the numbers in heat index, we talk about it so much in the Philippines, that kind of unprecedented numbers, right? We talk about heat index in Celsius around 40. There are reports that it can even go up as high as 50. And I know, yeah. Ms. Rina, that you visited Catanduanes lately, where the heat index is around 39 to 40. Really hot, just to say the least. It was. So what was your experience? What did you see? What did you observe? And how can we, you know, address the effects of the El Nino phenomenon, at least here in the Philippines?
Yes, thank you. Look, we did. We've come here to the Philippines because of exactly this El Nino impact. The temperatures, as you know better than me, they're going up and up and up. We met with communities. We talked to government officials. We actually saw the situation for people and how they're trying to cope. And, you know, a couple of things that are being done, we think can be learned for lessons for other parts of the world. The government here reacted quite quickly last year, announcing that this El Nino was coming and started helping to prepare communities. But, you know, with climate change, we need to be also looking ahead, because this is only just going to get worse.
Mm-hmm. So what do the communities need the most on ground?
What they're looking for is safety, obviously. With El Nino, the next step is, unfortunately, warm waters over the Pacific. And as you know, the island I went to is the gateway of typhoons. So they're preparing for potential typhoons later this year. So they want safety. But also what they're asking for is sustainable livelihoods. What happens if they can't keep growing crops? What happens, you know, if the water is reduced? So we're looking and discussing adaptation to climate change. And the government, actually, that was quite a large part of our discussions on what needs to come. And then lastly, I would say Philippines has been a real champion on loss and damage. It's a country least responsible and most affected. And so now it's time for some of those global commitments to come home.
You talked about sustainable livelihood, and when you talk about these external factors, that it's beyond the control of the people, right? When you talk about planting crops, when you talk about their livelihood and how the weather is affecting that, it's actually counterproductive, right? So in your opinion, or top of mind, what can they do at least for the residents in Catanduanes? They're a case study. But of course, there are more Filipinos in other islands that may be experiencing the same situation.
Oh, absolutely. Look, about half of the harvesting land in the Philippines is affected. 1.4 million people are facing drought today. So there's a lot of people affected. And what some of the things that can be done is preparing for the medium term. So looking at solar instead of hydro, there's going to be less water, but there's still plenty of sun. And looking at how to use energy through ways like that. Dams being prepared, irrigation systems based on solar networks. There's a whole lot of resilience initiatives that can be done, as well as drought-resistant seeds. So we were out there talking to communities about their ideas. They have solutions, and right now the government is working on some of those for the future.
Well, as from your observation, was potable water also an issue?
Yes, absolutely. There is definitely an issue with potable water. And of course, if we're not careful, that comes with disease outbreaks and all sorts of other things. So they are looking at now how to pump water further into the ground using solar systems. But it is a problem. It's drying up.
Well, of course, when the system is put in place, all of these problems will just, you know, branch out and may solve on its own one by one, given that there is a sustainable system to be put out in the first place. Now, lastly, Ms. Rina, the UN's efforts, you know, in choosing the Philippines, why? And what is UN doing to help the Philippines, you know, navigate the dire effects of El Nino?
So the first reason we chose to come to the Philippines is because it's a country that has been used to and prone to disasters. It's also developed quite sophisticated early warning systems and preparing communities ahead of time. So we wanted to learn from that. But secondly, also to make sure that the UN is supporting the government as it's been requested. And so we're preparing and getting communities ready for what's to come. We're looking at cash distributions, and we've also been supporting the government on dams and irrigation rehabilitation and ponds. So we're working in conjunction with those sorts of things we just talked about that need to be done.
Where to next, Ms. Rina?
I'm heading back to Southern Africa, actually, which is where the epicenter of El Nino is, actually.
Yes. And how's the situation, just for a context for us Filipinos here?
Well, Southern Africa is facing an extreme disaster. Many countries have actually called for a state of disaster. 31 million people or more are affected by the drought there. And it's going to be a situation that they're dealing with for a very long time, even after El Nino is gone. So it's severe.
All right. So there you have it. Thank you so much. And safe travels, Ms. Rina Galani, UN Assistant Secretary General. Thank you so much, Rina.
Thank you.
Thank you.